Welcome to the Lighthouse Church of Benton on this Wednesday night. We are so glad for those of you that could come out and be in service with us this evening. If you are watching from live stream, we welcome you. And if you have a prayer request, you can send it in during praise and worship, and we will pray with you. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise, every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise, every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise, every praise, every praise is to our God. 'Cause we sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise, every praise, every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise, every praise, every praise is to our God. 'Cause we sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise, every praise, every praise is to our God. 'Cause he's God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer. Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Well, he's God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer. Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Well, he's God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer. Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise,
every praise,
every praise,
every praise
is to our God. 'Cause we sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise,
every praise,
every praise,
every praise
is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise,
every praise,
every praise is to our God. 'Cause we sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise,
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 every praise is to our God.
can't see where my spirit longs to be. It's a place of healing. It's a place I live in freedom.
I'm gonna lift my hands till I can reach heaven. I'm gonna shout your name till the walls come falling down. I've come to worship. I've come to worship. Like I am unashamed, I'm gonna share. the mention of her name.
Mighty, you are mighty.
are mine. Jesus, you are mine. You are mine. Jesus, you are mine.
I was running and you found me.
I was blind
and you gave me sight. You put a song of praise in me. Oh, I was broken and you healed me. I was dying and you gave me life. Lord, you are my identity. And I know.
Well, it's good to be gathered together in the name of the Lord tonight. Amen? Yes, it is. Been a good hot day. No rain here. It rained somewhere in the world today, but not here. And so we just enjoyed a good hot day that we can get together and Marie be fanning there and air conditioner's going. Got the comforts of our church building and the gathering together. You know, in some parts of the world, it's hot where they're at, gathered together. But here we've got air conditioning, and we're thankful for that. Tonight is Variety Night. Yes, it is. So we are here to share with one another what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. I mean, He's done good things. So we want to hear about it tonight. Share it with the world. By the word of your testimony and the blood of the Lamb, you overcome. So we want to testify to God's goodness and God working. We've already got a testimony here. This guy always has a testimony. This guy is an overcomer. Amen? Yeah, we're going to step right up here, and I want you to testify.
So you know what? The devil said to me that say goodbye to your mom, it's time to die. And he is a liar. and Oreo died. He's a good doggy. I know Corey misses him. God is the best. Someday, you anyone that passed away, you can see him someday.
There you go. You never know. Okay. Thank you, Lord. I'll tell you what, it's one thing for sure, our children absorb what's around them. And that is where we have the privilege of sharing the good things of God so they can absorb the truth and grow thereby. Yes. Who else has a testimony tonight? Good word shared with the body. Brother John.
Well, I've been going on for several years now. I've had respiratory issues. I have come to find out I have severe COPD. Well, I've been seeing a doctor for 10 years now. No, yeah, I'll be 10 years next year. And just nothing got better. And come to find out he was leaving the office where I go, so I got me a new doctor. I've seen him twice. I seen him yesterday, and he'd done a lot of tests on me yesterday, a walking test. My pulse oxygen was real, real low, but I hadn't took no medicine before I went up there, and they did all these tests, breathing tests, walking tests, all that, and they sent a bunch of oxygen machines out to the house, which I don't know if I need yet or not. I'm standing on not needing them, but he gave me some new medicine to go with what I've got, I've been taking. And the wheezing, I was wheezing in and out both ways. And I've took two doses of it. I took a dose this morning. I haven't wheezed like that today, which is a blessing. And I'm just standing on my word, my Job 27:3. And, you know, God is our healer. By his stripes we're healed. And I'm going to stand on that. And I just want to get all my prayer warriors to come down here and lay hands on me and pray for me right now.
I'm getting better. By the word of his testimony, he overcomes. Anybody want some oil? We anoint with oil in the name of the Lord. Because that's what the Bible says to do. The oil has no healing power, but the demonstration of faith and the confession of faith is where the power is, because that connects to the power source. Who is God? God is the power source. So tonight we're going to pray for Brother John, and he is going to get a release in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, we lift up to you, John. We see his faith just as the people who brought the man to Jesus, and they tore the roof off to let the man down at Jesus' feet. It says that Jesus saw their faith and the man was healed. So, Father, we present to you the faith of the Son of God that you've imparted to us, and we lift John back up to you right now where he is standing in his confession of faith. We join together with him. Job 27:3, he has the breath of God in his lungs. We speak strength to his lungs. We speak release and cleansing to his body. We command that oxygen count to get up to normal. Everything that needs to be in his body, what he's been battling with, what he's been standing with, in the name of Jesus, we join together to say, be freed from that condition once for all and forever in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You are the power. It's your kingdom. It's your glory. It's your working, Lord. It's you in Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. Lungs be normal. COPD depart. The name of Jesus is over this vessel. This vessel is the Lord's. Satan, get your hands all off of him. You have no place in him. The blood of Jesus has purchased him. He's God's property. So we speak release to him tonight. In Jesus' name, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Shelley, do you have that video that I sent? If you could get that prepared to show at some point. Yes, now would be a good time. I have a video, and I'll go ahead and share because it'll fit right in. Tyler, could you cut some lights, sanctuary lights? I have a video here. Wood splitting. I don't know if you can see it on live stream. I'm splitting wood with a wood splitter. Notice right here, this is a hydraulic wood splitter. All I have to do is pull the lever. The power to split the wood is in the machine. It's not my power. In fact, one day Grayson was there when I was splitting wood and he pulled the lever. And it still split the wood just like when I pulled the lever. Because the power is not in me, it's not in the vessel, it's in the machine. So there we go. Splitting wood. And the lesson is, just like when we prayed for John, the power is not in the vessels and our ability, even our understanding, but the power is in God. He's the machine. He's the power. And so our faith, we believe His word, we speak and ask, and we receive, and it's done. The wood is split because it doesn't depend on us. It depends on Him. Jesus suffered and died to take our sins away. He suffered and took a beating in His body to take our sicknesses away. By His stripes we're healed. By His sacrifice we are set free from sin. It's God's power. It's God's righteousness. And we just believe Him. And receive what He has done for us. Therefore, it's John's desire and request to be healed, to be set free from that. He receives it. And we agree because it's God's power. And we don't move away from that. All we do is pull the lever of faith. Just pull the lever of faith and let God do the splitting. Amen? Amen. And I wanted to share that today, and that's why I wanted to share it right then. Because that's a good demonstration of what happens when we pray for one another. God's power is released if we'll pull the lever of faith.
Whenever we were praying for Mr. John, I also received it. Amen. Also. He's no respecter of person. What he does for one, he'll do for another.
Amen. That's right. It was on my heart, too. We're going to be baptized. John and I are going to go out there to baptize 7 inmates this Saturday at 5. Give God praise, yes. And it was on my heart to share with them that very thing, that when a word is spoken over somebody, first of all, you realize that we're one body in Christ. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father above all. We're one. Okay, so when a word is spoken over a brother or sister, receive it for yourself. We're all one together. Receive it for yourself. I wanted to share that with them because a lot of times we pray for one another and say, well, I wish I could get that prayer. Well, guess what? If you're hearing those words, get it. Take it. Receive it. That's right. And run with it because freely you've received, freely give. God's not stingy with His blessings. So we just share His blessings freely, and it's like jewels cast out there. Pick them up, put them in your pocket, and it's yours. Amen. Praise God. Who's going to be next tonight? Variety night. We want to share with one another. Come on down, Philip.
Got to make a presence up here. You know, I'm so thankful, like always, and I always sound so generic, I feel to myself. Because, you know, when I pray, I always just say, thank you, God, for everything that you have given me. Because he has given me everything that I have, everything that I got, it's because of him. You know, he is my provider, he's my comforter, he's my healer. There ain't anything that he's not. You know, and that's what gets me. You know, before, when you're not a believer, you're alone and you think everybody's against you, and you want what everybody else has, or you're thinking you're not good enough, and you're just sitting in your stuff. Let me just put it that way. You're just sitting in your self-pity and sorrow, but now you got the Lord. And you could raise your hands up and say, thank you, Lord, just help me get through this. I know it's temporary. I know it's going to pass. Just get me through it. And he does. And, you know, and we were talking yesterday. We went out to supper with Jackie and Barb. And for some way, we got on Googling everything about the Bible. Everything from how tall Jesus is to why people speak in tongues to how big the giants are. Google has a lot of stuff, let me tell you that. And Jesus was 5'5", and guess what? I'm 5'5". So, hey, you know, there ain't no proof of that, but that's what everybody thinks. But, you know, hey, but you know what there is proof is in the Word of God. And, you know, you got to just believe that. And, you know, we were talking yesterday how you could read a verse and a month later read the same verse and it means something different. It's just what spirit you're in and how the spirit's moving you and how everything, you know. But I know I could just come to him and say, Psalm 7 says, oh Lord my God, in thee do I put my trust. Save me from all that persecute me and deliver me. You know, one of the things I learned when I first got clean and sober, there's the serenity prayer. It said, God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. You know that I was real good about blaming everybody else for my problems. I didn't want to accept nothing. It was all them that did it. It was all my dad left me, you know. Even though my mom gave me all the love there was to give, I really didn't need a dad, you know. But any way I could find self-pity and find a reason to really do drugs and alcohol, I found it, you know. Either, you know, because I didn't have a real bad childhood. There's things that happened, but I had love. I had family. I had older brothers and sisters, and we all, you know, we fought. But, hey, what siblings don't. But with all of that, I'm just glad that the life God has given me today, and that everything that has, I believe, that I've gone through and been through and experienced has been to help other people. You know, hey, we don't have to be alone. There ain't no reason in this world that someone has to be alone. So, and like I just said, the Bible says it all. The Lord will be my refuge for the oppressed, a refuge in times of trouble. It tells me that. So why would I want to live without him? When I can have so much with him, why would I want to live without him? You know, and that's all I got to say. Thank you.
Good. Psalm 7, Psalm 7, 8, and 9, okay? Yep. Who's going to be next? God is our all-sufficient, ever-present help in time of need. The Father, the Son, the Spirit, whatever we need, we got it in him. Amen.
Philip, that's awesome. I love getting to watch Philip. I love Variety Night because I love watching him open up and it gets a little bit longer, and he shares a little bit more, and he shares a little bit more, and it's awesome to watch people grow in God like that. And it's a testimony in itself, not just to hear the words, but to see the reaction in person, because once you start going through that walk and it happens that way, you can't help but express what you're seeing, how you're growing, and what God's doing in your life. So, man, that's awesome. I just want to give you credit on that. I want to open with a testimony. Kind of like how, I think it was Brother Jackie a while ago, that said how our kids absorb the environment that you put them in. So we got Gabriel a phone not too long ago, because as y'all know, he lives in Monticello and we live here, and I always have to call his mom, wait on a call back or wait. So I said, you know what, we're just going to get him a phone and he can call me when he wants to. I can call him when he wants to. We can text. And another night, I'm sitting on the couch and Gabriel sent me a text message. It said, hey, Dad, are you busy? I said, no, bud, what's up? And he said, I want you to pray for my brother. He has strep throat. May not seem like a big deal, but it is to me to know my 10-year-old son, when his brother is sick, that he knows exactly where to go and exactly what to do. And that is a big testimony in itself for me. So I'm thankful that God allows their hearts and minds to be open and have a home like this where they do get to witness that. They get to see ones healed in our church and get to see us lay hands and pray, and they learn that, and it sticks with them. No matter what life tries to throw at them or the world tries to bring before them, they're going to remember what they saw, witnessed, felt in a house like this to take with them. So I'm very thankful for that. I can't take credit for a lot of this. I know God has opened my eyes and expanded me a lot of it, but the general sense of itself, what I want to share tonight is actually in a sermon that I've listened to the last 2 days. I want to open up with, or start with some scripture, Isaiah 53, starting in verse 2. And I'm going to read down through verse 6. For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. We are all like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. The beginning of that scripture speaks of the Messiah as a tender plant, a root out of dry ground. I don't know about you guys, but I'm fighting it right now. You know, with our house built, we had sod put down, and I constantly have to go outside and rotate sprinklers every on this corner, on this corner, on this corner, on that corner. I've got spots that are big brown ones because they don't get any sunlight. There's no sunlight feeding them. There's no, being a homeowner, I thought it is fun. Lord, thank you. I'm not trying to complain about it, but oh my goodness. Oh, the chores list. But sharing that just to explain, for the grass to grow, you have to have water, you have to have sunlight, you have to have nutrients, you have to have good soil, topsoil. If it's just rocks underneath it, or it's not going to grow, it's not going to spread like it's supposed to. The Messiah was explained as a plant that not just grew, but took root in dry ground. You see, God, Jesus don't need things from you to be able to grow in your life. The big misconception that pastor speaks about all the time is that you think that I've got to be good. I've got to get this done. I've got to get that done. I've got to quit this. I've got to quit that before I can allow Jesus to be in my life. When you don't, all you have to do is give Jesus space, and he'll do the rest. I know one's here, y'all know that, but everybody out there, you on live stream, you have got to know you don't have to be perfect. You don't have to get to a point that you're, okay, Lord, I'm ready. Now we can go somewhere. That's what grace and mercy are for. It's not for you just to free reign and act however you want to. But when Jesus died on the cross and said, it is finished, he meant it is finished. All he needs to do for us to do is to give him space. Give him space in our finances. Give him space in our health. Give him space in our family. Give him space in our daily lives. Just give him space. It don't matter if you're dry ground. It don't matter if it's raining that day or if it's not raining that day. If you have sunshine in your life or it's cloudy in your life. It does not matter what's going on. If you simply just give Jesus the space to be there and watch him grow and watch what he will do in your life. Because I know myself that I, Pastor can't hear, I'm far from being where I know I'm supposed to be. Oh. But you see, what I decided to do is give Jesus the space. To give him the time. Every single day. One thing by one thing, I'm still learning to let go of this, to open up more here. But it's nothing that I'm doing. Yes, it's through the vessel of me, but it's nothing that I can accomplish or nothing that I can do. But if I give him the space to do it and the opportunity and be willing, he will grow. And it's contagious. He'll grow from me. He'll grow to you. He'll grow to anybody else that you come across and you show him that. And that's all I have tonight, guys.
Amen. You know, the difference in religion and a relationship, religion says, you gotta do this, you gotta do that. A relationship says, he gave you, he gives, he has given. It's what he has done, and as you give space to that, then you get a relationship where you're not constrained unto him, but you see what he has done for you. And that's a relationship. That's a loving relationship. Instead of you got to do this and you got to do that and rules and regulations, it becomes a relationship of love and obedience, submission, receiving his blessings and giving him praise day and night. Amen. Who's next? Good word here tonight. Come on down, Becky. Preach to us. Now try to limit it to 10 minutes, okay? Okay.
Well, it's good to be here tonight. And what I would like to share, I don't know why God placed it on my heart, but he did. And it kind of ties in with some of the things that Tyler says. I want to talk about witnessing. You know, God does not call us all to be pastors, teachers, music directors, pianist, whatever. He sure didn't call me to be any of those, but he has called me to witness, and he's called all of us, once we're saved by God's grace, to witness to others. So I want to share ways to witness, because I, for one, it was hard for me to open up. I've gotten better as the years have went on, and I've grown in the Lord, but it was really hard for me just to walk up and start a conversation about salvation. But here's one of the ways that we can witness, and that's by our life, our own life. Are we in church on Sunday morning singing, "Oh, how I love Jesus," and Monday morning we're there for the devil? You know, people see that. They want to see consistency in the Christian life. And that's something we need to be really careful with. And another way to start the conversation is ask a question. This is one that my pastor uses that I've borrowed from him. And it's, if you were to die today and stand before God, and he said, "Why should I let you into my heaven?" What would you say? You'll hear answers like, "Well, I go to church, I give to the poor, I give to charity, I take care of my family, I tithe every Sunday." And then that leads you to say, "While all those things are good, not things to do, that will not get you to heaven." You know, you can't work out salvation. You can't climb one rung of the ladder by giving, you know, rung number two by being at church. It just doesn't work that way. Another way is when you're talking to a person, personalize John 3:16. And we know this all well, but we could say something like, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And if Becky will believe in him, Becky will not perish, but she will have eternal life. People understand personalization more, seems like. And that kind of goes, okay, they're talking, God's talking about me here. Another way is give an example. Say we're talking about sin, and the scripture in Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Well, we can give an example. Say they're kind of looking at you, kind of puzzled. Okay, sin, what does that mean? How do I fall short? So I want to borrow Pastor Barbara for an example. Okay, you can sit there. Pastor Barbara says, all of you line up in front of this pulpit, and in one jump, I want you to jump to the back door. Some of us might jump 10, 15 feet. Some of us would jump 6 inches or a couple of feet. But the point is, we all fall short. And a lot of times an example, something like that, will help people understand, oh, okay, I get it. So I've done wrong, and there's no way that I can make it to heaven. Oh, I need to, you know, then you can continue with salvation and how to receive Jesus. And then last of all, always pray for God to give us the words to say in any situation. And Psalms 32:8 says it well. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. God impressed it upon my heart to talk to a neighbor a few years back. I had no clue what to say. The man was dying of cancer. I didn't know anything about his soul. So I just went over there and started the conversation. Hey, how are you feeling? And, of course, we talked a little bit about his health. And then I said, how is your relationship with the Lord? I said, do you know him? Have you asked him to save you? Have you asked him to forgive you of your sins? And he just kind of stared at me, and I, you know, shared a little more of the word. And I asked him, would he like to pray? And so I kind of led him in prayer. He prayed, of course. I couldn't save him, obviously, but he did come to know the Lord before he died. And I'm so thankful, because I was so afraid to go over there. And I told my best friend at the time, I said, I don't know what to say. I don't know how to open up the conversation. She said, well, I'll tell you this advice. If the Lord's telling you to go over there, you better go. So I just kind of went over there and prayed, Lord, just give me the words to say. Amen. That's all I have.
That's great. Absolutely. May the Lord give us boldness to speak for him. You know, when I was in India and in Russia, there was two things in common to those two events that I was part of. And most of the time, we're hesitant to approach people about the Lord. But over there, I realized that that should not be, because once you break through that barrier, those people are so hungry. Why didn't you come earlier? I wish you'd been here earlier. You know, they're waiting on us. The fields are white unto harvest. God's waiting on the harvesters. The crop's ready to harvest. If we're willing to step out there, then you'll find there's a harvest. There is a harvest, tremendous. And I'll always remember that about India and Russia, is that, my goodness, why was I holding back? Because these people are wanting what I've got to offer them. They're eager to hear it and receive it. And you know, it's the same thing in America. We don't think it's that way, but step out there and start talking. You'll find out there's some hungry people out there. Amen? Amen. Good word, sister. Good word. Come on down, Shelley. Okay. She's going to get something off the printer. It's always so rich and good when we get together and share like this. And it always, if you listen, there's a message. There is a message from the various sources. The Spirit is speaking to us this hour for His purpose come to pass. That's what I always enjoyed about home meetings, is people sharing everything, and you get the message, and then you bring it out, and it's a great message.
Okay, for those of you that have watched Sunday's sermon, I sang Amazing Grace. And I have sang Amazing Grace before, and it has never hit me, the words, the way they affected me that day. I saw that song in a different light that day. And so it got me to thinking about grace and what it truly means to be given God's grace and to receive God's grace and to show grace to others. And so I looked up some things. It says, what is the true meaning of grace? And it says, grace is the basis for the Christian faith. We are saved by faith through grace. It is defined as undeserved favor. It is not earned. It is not freely given, but it is undeserved favor. And we count on God's grace. And it builds a relationship with Him. And then I thought, well, how can I show grace to others? Because I want for people to see God's grace in me, and I want to be the light to others. And to show grace to others is to simply forgive them unconditionally, just as God forgave us through Christ. In Colossians, it says, bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And in 2 Corinthians, Jesus says to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. So the grace was made in my weakness, in my failures, in my shortcomings. I have received grace. And then I have another one in 1 Corinthians. Paul is saying to a group, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And His grace toward me was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not but the grace of God which was with me. So years ago, it's been probably about 5 years, I suppose, God gave me a song, and it's called Falling Into Grace. And with that, I see it in a different light since Sunday. It means more to me now than it did when it was written. And if you're willing, I would love to sing it tonight.
word that is strengthening me. It's your love that is carrying me.
Yes,
it's such a warm embrace, 'cause I'm falling into your
exalted in this place. Thank you, Lord. Be exalted, O Lord. Yes. The Lord is exalted in this place. It's Him. It's Him. It's not about us. It's Him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Lord, well, first I've got a testimony I want to give. I was sharing this with someone that attends our church, and she said, you've got to give this publicly so everybody in other countries can know how awesome God is. So first of all, I'm going to say that you cannot outgive God. And, you know, I was sharing, I talked with my pastor in Portland, Oregon today, and I was sharing with him what a loving church we have, what a giving church that we don't pass a plate. We don't, you know, we'll do nothing. I said, in fact, a lot of time people will come up and go put their tithes and offerings in the basket before church even starts, is because it's in their heart to obey God, you know. And so anyway, my testimony here is that this past Sunday, we had our zoo day, our church outside of the house fun day. And I was planning for the church. I've planned, you know, how much the church is going to spend. And so the short of the story is there is a lady who just started coming to church here, and God put it on her heart to pay for all the tickets. There were 25 of us that went to the zoo, and it put it on her heart to pay for all the tickets to get into the zoo, and it was just under $300. I was just thankful, so thankful. Thank the Lord for that. But then it was in my heart. I wanted everyone to ride the zoo train and to also ride the carousel. And so it seemed like everybody had a good time, and the church bought everybody's lunch. And so we're out, you know, just playing and having a good time. And so it come time for us to ride the train. And so we get up to the window, and I tell the gentleman, I said, this whole group is we're all one group, and how do you want to do this? And he said, just have everybody get on the train, and then we'll count, and I'll just take your word for what you got. And I said, okay. And before I could get a hold of Jackie to take a count, he said, don't count any of the children. I think that's how he said it, wasn't it? Don't count any children. Now, the rules and regulations is that any child over 3 must be counted. And so the only people that we paid for on the train was 11 people. More than half that we didn't pay. So a blessing that God showed us favor. Oh boy, this is so good. We ride on the train, and little Cross wanted to ride by me. And just as we were coming in to stop, he stood up and looked out. And just as he was looking out, there was a post there that seconds that we got that got him back on that train. And I knew there was an angel that kept that baby. If he had got hit in that head, it could have taken his life. And that, I knew it was a God thing all day long. And then we got to the carousel. I went into the gift shop to find out if I needed to pre-buy for the carousel, because there were, you know, a number of us. She said, no, you can buy your tickets out there. And I said, well, can we use a card? Because I was using the church card. She said, oh, yes, you can. You can get it right out there. So we all gather out there to go get on the carousel. I get up there, and I tell the young lady, I've got the card in my hand. I said, we're all one group right here. And she says, my machine right now is not working to take a card, so I'm just going to let you all ride free. Let's all say this out loud. You cannot outgive God. I'm telling you. And so, look, I love telling it. I love telling the testimony, because those kind of things don't just happen. It was all day. It was just an all-day deal. And it seemed like everyone had a good time and a good fellowship, and we teased and laughed and joked and cut up and had a great day. But the scripture that I want to give you tonight, and it most certainly has been manifested already in this house tonight, is Matthew chapter 18. In fact, I'll just give you 19 and 20. Verses 19 and 20. I was just going to give you 20, but I'm going to give you 19 and 20. And this is Jesus talking. And he says, again, I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. Verse 20 is what I want you to see. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. And so I want you to see this, that every time that you come to church, And that is why I'm going to keep preaching. Go to church if you're able. Go hook up with a body if you're able. Now, if you're not able, you know, you're bedfast or something at home and you can't go, by all means, get with us on live stream. Receive what you can through live stream. Yes. But where two or three are gathered, look at your neighbor, and I need you to tell them right now, Jesus is here. Let that sink in, that right now, right this moment, Jesus is here. And every time we gather in His name, He is here. And that is why we can lay hands on the sick and God raises them up. Amen. And that is why that out the clear blue, the word will come to you and you may share with someone, because Jesus is here. And I want you to get the depth of that every time, say every time. Every time you enter a place, because from the beginning, God gave instructions to build Him a place so He could dwell among men. Amen. He wants a place, and you say, well, I have Him in my heart. Yes, and I'm not talking about that. And you say, well, I have a place in heaven, and I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about when two or three gather together, Jesus is there. Amen. He's there. So every time you get ready to come to church, I can promise you there'll be challenges and opposition to keep you out of His house. Because the enemy knows the power that's waiting on you in His house. Amen. Man, that's what I got.
You know, Pastor, that got me thinking, and I don't want to go up there. When you were talking about He'll do anything to keep you out of His house, He will.
Yes.
Satan will do that. Well, you know what? He used a mosquito for me. Mosquito bit me right here under my eye. And when it did, my eyes almost swoke. It was almost closed. Well, this is the only eye I see out of. That was not a good day. That was not a good day. It gave me a really bad headache trying to see. But you know what? I'm here today. That's all I can say.
Amen. Yeah. Remember. Under 10 minutes, remember.
I know I am windy. I got some of Jackie in me. So I don't really have anything prepared tonight to talk. I didn't realize it was Friday night tonight, and I had to work late. So anyway, but the couple things I did just want to say is that coming on Monday, June the 12th, will mark 24 years since I've been born again. I was born again June 12th of 2009, and so this coming Monday will be 24 years. And I can promise you, in all those 24 years, not one day have I ever wanted to not serve God. I can't imagine life now without Him. You know what I mean? And I've done it for 24 years consistently. I love Him so much. And, you know, the one thing about coming to church, which is true, is that it kind of regrounds me back, because sometimes we just kind of I get caught up in stuff, you know, with work and my activities and the family and whatever's going on. I kind of get caught up on things, and I don't always spend the time that I should with the Lord. But when I come to church, it kind of regrounds me, and I get reassured that I'm okay. I'm okay just where I'm at. But one of the scriptures I wanted to read, it is one of my favorite scriptures, is Hebrews 1:9. And it says, "Thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Therefore God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. And you know, there's more to just being glad. When you have the oil of gladness, you know how it is when you get oil on your hands or on your body or whatever? It's very difficult to get off. It stays put. The oil of gladness from the Lord is not something that's coming to me externally. It's coming from the inside out. And I realize where I'm at in my life, that the things that I enjoy and the things that I treasure and I love are gifts from God. And I'm so thankful, and I feel so blessed by Him. And, you know, we always say that, we declare that at the end, you know, that whatever we put our hands to, God will bless it. And we're blessed coming in and going out. We make that declaration, and I'm glad that we do as a body, because it is very important for the enemy to hear where you stand. I want him to know where I stand. You know what I mean? I want him to know. And I feel very, very blessed. And I just want to always continue to have the ability to recognize that those things came from God. They're not in myself, but they're in what He has given me and blessed me with. My kids, my job, my husband, my home. I mean, the list just goes on and on. And I'm in a beautiful place in my life. And I really believe that it is from the blessings of God. And I so appreciate Shelley sharing about grace tonight. That opened my eyes about some things with grace too that I lacked understanding of. And so I appreciate you being obedient and sharing that. But that's all I had to say.
Amen. Again, it's about God giving to us. It's about God giving to us grace, mercy, good things. Bible says He gives us richly all things to enjoy. It's all about Him giving to us. His name is exalted. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
We sometimes take grace for granted.
Take grace for granted? I think we do most of the time. Yeah, because over a period of years, a definition of grace formulated in me, and it's a long definition, but it came about me seeing repeatedly God giving constantly, imparting constantly, enabling us constantly. And we're not even aware of it so many times. But when we start seeing what Shelley is seeing and what Jesselyn is seeing and sharing, the message to us tonight is God says, I'm giving to you. See what I'm giving to you, and let me be exalted in your eyes. Because, as Jesselyn said, we get so caught up with our stuff and our things, and we forget that grace is operating in the midst of it all. Grace is operating all the time. We expect it a lot of times. Take it for granted. Expect it. When what we need to be doing is we see that it's grace that's coming to us, and just fall on our face with praise and worship and thanksgiving and adoration and love expressed to Him. Because He is giving, not just has given, but He is giving so much to us constantly. It's grounds for worship every day. Every day. Thanksgiving. Not to take it for granted, but to recognize it and give Him praise. Amen? And as Becky was saying, you know, we need to be a light. Yeah. Well, as He fills the horizon of our consciousness, we're all caught up with Him. And that is the light. Him in our life is the light. So let us be caught up with what His grace is toward us, and His power, and His working. And as we're that, we're going to be a light. Amen. What a message and what a ministry. Thank you, Lord. And in that grace and in that power, we get to pray for somebody. Prayers to be able to deal with someone I've forgiven, but they still try to come against me. Anybody experienced that? Let's read that again. Somebody said that's a regular, okay? Listen, we all have to struggle with getting hurt and reacting and dealing with that, all right? Prayers that I'll be able to deal with someone I've forgiven, but they still try to come against me. Somebody in the body have a word to say about that before we pray for this person? Because this applies to all of us. I'll tell you the word that comes to me. In Ephesians 6, Paul talked about putting on the armor of God. And we read through that, and a lot of times we go through the mechanics of that. But you get down to verse, I think it's 16. Ephesians 6:16. Does it say praying always? Above all. Yeah.
Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fire darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And, you know, a lot of times when we, because we're Christian, and we have an encounter with someone, or things get out of hand or whatever, we think that because we're Christian that we're just supposed to take that. But nowhere in the Bible does it say that. I'm just going to say that. The reason that I follow Jesus is because he's my hero. He went into a temple with a braided whip and ran a bunch of men out for abusing the house of God. And so if someone is not following the Word of God, then they are not just coming against you, they are coming against God. But you stay in the Word. But, you know, the enemy will come right here and say, well, you haven't forgiven them. But I can tell you many times that you forgive them in here, but just because thoughts and stuff, that's where the enemy works. He works here, trying to get you to think you didn't forgive them, but you did forgive them in your heart. And I can tell you this, that when it come down to if that person was dying and you knew they were going to die and go to hell, and you know you would go and try to get them to pray through, you have forgiven them. Yes, that's right. That you don't want them to burn in hell. Yes. That you want them to go to heaven. And so don't take a bunch of stuff thinking you're supposed to because you're Christian. But you stand up for what is right and do not engage. You know, the Bible doesn't say sit down and chit chat with the devil. Don't engage. When you're done, you're done. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now, what does that verse say about praying always? Read that again.
Verse 18. Chapter 6, verse 18 says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. In the Spirit. And watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints.
What stood out to me one day was, all this armor and the operation of this armor all comes together by verse 18. By praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Does everybody know what in the Spirit means? That means you give that place to Jesus in your life so that you get inspired by His Spirit. It's His working, His Spirit. Praying in the Spirit, praying in the Holy Ghost, praying with tongues, praying with understanding. But it's in that place of yieldedness to Him so that He's directing your prayer for all saints. Yes. For all saints.
And I'm going to say this, that you do not have any control over another human being.
That's right.
None. If you try to control their thoughts and how their actions are, now you're operating in witchcraft. That's according to the Bible. You do not have control over what they do or say. You do over what you do or say. And so just put it in the hands of the Lord. You pray for them. And you leave it in the hands of the Lord. And it, look, if I had someone right here that wants to argue with me or wants to come against me, you know what I'm going to say? I'm not going to be a part of this. Whatever your opinion is of me, that's your opinion. But I'm not going to be a part of this. And so sometimes we just have to use the wisdom of God to get through difficulties. Amen? Amen. Amen. I hope this helped.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen. And so right now, Father, we just lift up this prayer request. We lift this person up.
For Cheryl.
First of all, Cheryl is her name.
Cheryl.
That we lift up Cheryl. And Lord, we thank you that you are not about abuse in any way. You're not about physical, emotional, or spiritual abuse in any way. And I thank you, Father, that we do not have to take any of that or put up with any of that. Just want to thank you for that. I just want to praise you for that, that you are our rear guard and you go before us and you make our way straight. And Father, right now I lift this young lady up that she not be a victim ever again. There'll be no, she'll not be a victim ever again. Just want to thank you for that. Just want to praise you. And Lord, I thank you that that if you shut the lion's mouths in the den for Daniel, shut the mouth of the lion this night that is coming against this woman. In Jesus' name. And I thank you, Lord. I thank you for guarding angels that are placed around her to keep her and to keep her safe. In Jesus' name. We decree it and declare it and call it done. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And grace. Grace be to Cheryl. Grace be to Cheryl.
Amen.
Well, she understands what grace is. The grace and the operation of God be upon Cheryl. Grace in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Good things being accomplished tonight. Good word. Being built up, edified in Him. Come on, Marty.
The power of God, what He's done in our lives. When we went on vacation, I was standing looking out over the ocean, and it made me feel small that He had to be so big to create this big earth that I'm just a dot in that ocean if it wasn't for that boat. Not even to be seen. But the power He inflicts on our lives and the beauty that He displays, that He gives us to enjoy. And what He does for one, He will do for the other. My mother is, she's a living miracle. What He does, but she loves Jesus, and He knows it, and He's going to take care of her. So I do want to sing a song. If you don't mind playing it for me.
Is that too high? You sing it in D?
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider
I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, so my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation, and takes me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I will in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, how great thou art, how great you are. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou
art. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Our God is exalted. Hallelujah! He's exalted. Hallelujah! He's exalted. Thank you, Lord. 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 Be exalted, oh God. Be exalted. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Sing it, Barbara. Thank you, Jesus.
Sing my soul. Savior, my God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Jesus, my Lord, oh, unto thee, how great thou art. Oh, how great thou art.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Marty, will you come sing I Love You, Lord? Receive some healing. Get ready to receive right there. Little basta roca sala prendere de vicadeasa. Eco poikina wishkataha. Meke de vidabedeshe. Laria mamba borunga saste kele prekatele to be end of the barasas tahaya. Rukata bafrendere de vi osher of the basasa la bahai tese. Mingiando corroco paprakata, yes, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Take in a deep breath right now. Just take in a deep breath. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, right there, right there. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for restoring and repairing and renewing. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes. Thank you, Lord, and even a good sleep tonight, Lord. I decree and declare, yes, a good rest, a peaceful rest in Jesus' name. Just thank you, Lord, for the crowning, for the crowning. Lord, I thank you for that your glory filled this place, in Jesus' name. Thank you for it, Lord. And also, Lord, I pray that her heart be strengthened and that her heart be strengthened with might in Jesus' name. Right there. Yes, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yes.
And that oil of gladness rise Glory. Up in her. Thank that you. Oil of gladness. In the name of Jesus. Fresh anointing with the oil of gladness. The anointing. The anointing. That destroys every yoke of bondage.
Thank you, Lord.
Rise up and be upon you in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes, hallelujah.
Oh, my goodness. Yes. Yes, I know.
You know, just wouldn't go away.
Yes, I know.
I'd feel pretty good for a little couple of hours, and then hear it come back, you know. And it's the nose and the throat and some of the chest, you know. And it was awful. It's awful. And I feel like I've been touched
yes,
tonight.
Yes, amen. You
and
have
I feel,
been.
I know I'm going to sleep good tonight.
Yes, amen.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name
Thank
of
you,
Jesus. Yes,
amen.
Hallelujah. Well, I tell you, this is one of those nights it's hard to even, let's go home, you know. But isn't it good to be in this presence? And just remember when you step in this house Sunday morning to know that if another person will step in to also, when another person comes, there's two in this house. Jesus is here. He's here. Isn't that good? Isn't that good? All right, stand on your feet. Are you ready for your blessing?
Yep.
All right, I'm blessed.
I'm blessed.
I'm blessed in the city and the field.
I'm blessed in the city and the field.
I'm blessed coming in and going out.
I'm blessed coming in and going out.
And everything I put my hands to,
everything I put my hands to,
God causes it to prosper.
God causes it to prosper.
Our children shall marry the right person the first time.
At the right time.
Our children's hearts and minds are open
to receive knowledge and wisdom
and the powerful word of God
and speak it forth.
I am a light.
I cannot be hid.
I am salt of the earth
that causes mankind to thirst for God.
I'm full,
filled up,
and running over with health, wholeness, completeness, nothing missing, nothing broken. And we give all honor and praise to God in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll see you Sunday morning at 10 o'clock.